Before we begin, this video is sponsored by Surfshark VPN. Now, while I've got your attention, this particular topic is very niche and jargon heavy by its own nature, and I'll do my best to keep it simple and relevant. I want to give a huge thanks to our medical research team, especially Dr. Sherpa, where you can learn more about them at the COOV's website. The midface is incredibly important for aesthetics because, as research has shown, our initial perceptions of a person are formed from a seemingly innocuous part of their face. This region from brow to the nasal base determines the shape of your most important facial features, namely the eyes and nose. Wider midfaces tend to develop wider eye openings, as in the distance from corner to corner, and not the eyeball itself, to stay in proportion. This creates a masculinized frontal profile, helping to achieve better brow ridge projection, deep set eyes, a projected under eye region, and a square face shape. Truly a 4-for-1 deal. So keep that in mind next time you're at the pick your face garage sale. So this begs the question, is there a way to bring the upper jaw, that's responsible for the midface, forwards to address the underlying problems? Conventionally, aesthetic medicine applies implants and fillers to recessed or hyperplastic regions, which addresses one cosmetic flaw at a time. This is more of a band-aid solution than an actual fix. With technological advancements in internal rods, it may actually be viable for distraction osteogenesis, an alternative procedure to be discussed to advance the midface for less severe cases, and maybe even cosmetically in the future. Distraction osteogenesis, callus distraction, callotasis or osteodistraction are all names for a medical procedure that is often used in orthopedic and reconstructive surgery to repair skeletal deformities. The aim of the procedure is to make a longer bone out of a smaller one and was initially used in the treatment of unequal leg length. While watching a video on the history of limb lengthening by Dr. Draw Paley, the man who basically wrote the book on the topic multiple times, he mentioned something very interesting. According to him, the future of osteogenic surgery will include internal rods that are so small and so strong that they can be used to lengthen craniofacial bones. For facial aesthetics, one of the biggest bottlenecks is in moving about already set bone structure. Someone with a recessed midface or unusual facial convexity are basically stuck with it unless they resort to an incredibly invasive osteotomy that cuts the bone and repositions it, which is obviously traumatic for the body. For the lower jaw, recessed or malformed mandibles have to go through genioplasty or double jaw surgery, but neither of these options actually physically lengthen the bone with new growth. Instead, they only move around what is already there. What if there was a way to create new bone growth to get the ideal bone structure? As it turns out, since the early 1980s, osteogenesis, or the process of cutting the bone to encourage new bone growth, was considered for use in the treatment of congenital and acquired jaw deformities. The biggest difference being that they used external fixators, which are bulky, heavy, and restrictive, whereas Dr. Paley is suggesting that in the future, we will see a greater use of advanced internal fixators, such as smaller rods that can go in the bone itself, can provide biofeedback, and are much stronger than current technology. A quick break from all of that to help you process, let's talk about our video sponsor. I've partnered up with Surfshark VPN because in doing research for every video, our team comes across a certain problem that's quite common in academia, region-locked articles. For whatever reason, some articles, especially the more niche research papers, are region-locked to a specific country or exclude others. Surfshark allows you to virtually change your location to unblock this said content. Most of you know what a VPN does, whether it be to obscure your online identity and avoid pesky ads that follow you around the web, or watch Netflix shows before they come to your region. Surfshark, much like all VPNs, offers you the ability to access the internet as if you were in another country. However, unlike the competitors, they are a lot cheaper, allowing you to use one account for an unlimited number of devices, which is just fantastic value. For us, this means moving from Australia to Vietnam, where for some odd reason, the subscription to research publishers is around 50% cheaper after conversion. And for you, it might mean watching the latest episode of a show directly from Netflix US. You can use our code COOVS for 84% off with an extra 4 months for free. And look, if you feel like it's not for you, then there's a 30-day money-back guarantee with no questions asked. Support the brands that support the channel by paying them a visit with the link in the description. The procedure for distraction osteogenesis begins with the cutting of bone, from which a distractor device is placed in between the two cuts, and the bone is allowed to heal naturally on both ends. Orthopedic surgeons, quite literally 100 years ago, knew of the possibility of this outlandish but logical procedure working. What they didn't know was how much to lengthen by or how to encourage better growth. Using intramedullary rods to correct fractures and bone deformities is standard procedure for most orthopedic surgeons, but they're more focused around the limbs and not the face. The technology and research isn't anything new, but its application in tiny facial bones is an entirely different game of risk. Before the bones start to heal, the device is activated, and it starts pulling the bones away at around a millimeter or less per day to mimic natural growth rates during puberty. This allows for new bone callus to fill the distance between the cut and the edges, hence elongating a shorter bone into a longer one. This bone comes back stronger and thicker, much like muscles at the gym, which isn't noticeable on your limbs, but it could be unsightly on the face. The surgery itself is commonly reserved for severe cases of oral and maxillofacial deformity, especially for the jaw. A retrospective analysis of 13 subjects with micrognathia, where the lower jaw doesn't grow at all, underwent distraction osteogenesis and showed that 10 out of 13 subjects achieved correct distractor placement and final mandibular position. In other words, it was successful. In more severe cases like these, placing an implant won't magically correct for a large chunk of missing bone, and this type of surgery is necessary. The osteogenic procedure has been performed for years as it has a high success rate in treating deformities like craniosynostosis, where a baby's skull fuses too quickly, causing the brain to push against it and make it misshapen as the child grows. According to the Indian Dental Academy, osteogenesis is used in 6 cases. For aesthetics, we're concerned with the first 2, but all 6 have the general theme of closing gaps in the bone. The type of tools that are most commonly used by maxillofacial surgeons to improve the midface are either internal or external fixators. They anchor to a stable part of the skull and apply very slow mechanical traction to redirect the forward growth, but as you can imagine, this stretches muscle, skin, bone, and nerve tissue all the same. While the bone, muscle, and skin can handle it, nerve tissue is much more temperamental, and excessive friction can cause function loss altogether. With the face being absolutely packed with nerves, this is no easy ordeal, and having this temporarily attached during distraction is a special type of hell. This rules out the surgery being viable for cosmetic reasons, as no doctor would take on that kind of liability for a perfectly healthy face that wants a minor improvement. However, with better internal fixators, the process could become more tolerable and thus reduce the threshold for what a doctor would consider acceptable to operate on. So how did these internal fixators work? Well, the first known case of internal use were in 1993, and since then, they've delivered some truly miraculous results to faces with no other hope. This particular version uses biodegradable base plates, reducing the need for a more invasive operation when it comes to removal. Initially, the distractor goes in closed, fitting into the gap where the surgeon has cut the bone, and using mechanical turns, it distracts itself along the distractor screw. This is a very simple version that still has a screw hole for the key to go in and turn the screw daily. In case it's not obvious, this means that there's a small hole in your face where the screw can go in, but this leaves you at greater risk of infection and leaving behind permanent scars, which is another reason it's not done for cosmetics, because it would do more harm than good to a mostly okay face. What we're expecting to come out in the future are electromagnetic distractors that don't rely on mechanical turns of a screw, but rather on electromagnetic pulses to turn tiny gears with astronomically high gear ratios, which turns a small amount of force into one that's big enough to physically remodel bone. This way, your face is fully sealed off, and apart from tiny scars on the surface, it's buried deep in the face. In a comparative clinical study performed by doctors at UCLA, the researchers compared two equally divided groups, one which had just undergone midface advancement using internal distractors, while the other had undergone the same procedure using external distractors. Both groups were analyzed, and it was found that the facial appearance, distraction length, and functionality were all scored the same for both groups. However, the scores for quality of life, as in dental anxiety, social function, and so on, were remarkably higher for internal devices than for external ones, which is the whole point of this video. Simply speaking, the internal devices were a lot more bearable. The point of this video wasn't to cover a medical's degree worth of osteogenic techniques in 10 minutes. Instead, it shows an appreciation for what aesthetic and functional medicine is actually capable of, where technology is actually allowing for the normalization of surgery, whether for aesthetic or functional reasons. The only real way of changing your bone structure after it's done growing is with tractional force, whether it be from braces in conventional orthodontics or with distractors to build new bone, as we've just covered. Osteogenesis over the years has been applied to clavicles to make the shoulders wider, arms and legs to correct asymmetries, and now faces to correct just about everything from the top down. As the tools improve, what was once a radical surgery will slowly become normalized and more bearable on its patients. What was once done for the worst of cases may even be performed for cosmetic reasons because the dangers will have been greatly managed by then. As it turns out, it is possible to change the once unchangeable parts of your face, but it won't come easy or cheap just yet.